Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to our December 8th worship service. I am Oscar Bickert Jr., and I am the worship leader this morning. Christmas Eve service is this Saturday at 5 p.m. All are invited to come celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior. Christmas Day service, come as you are, is at our usual time of 10 a.m. Please come for a fun time of worship and song because it is Christmas morning. You're invited to come as you are. If your tradition is to wear jammies all day Christmas, please come with your jammies. Adult and children, appropriate jammies only. Okay. The lights in the meditation garden, which are just wonderful, if you haven't seen them, stop by, take a look at them. Tim, Bill, Julian, it's really great. The lights in Meditation Garden can be viewed from dusk until midnight from now until January 5th. Be sure to drive by and see a beautiful sight. It's really nice. Thank you to all who donated toys and gifts and cards to the 2022 Toy Collection for Groveport Madison Human Needs. This year, we were blessed with 253 toys and 2 gift cards. A special thanks to all the helpers who helped count, pack up, and deliver the toys. Merry Christmas from the Missions Committee. The Missions Committee will be hosting another Gifts for Angels event on January 7. See the insert in your bulletin for more details. We currently need $1,256 to complete the funding for the first phase of the roof repairs. Please mark your donation for roof repair. Thank you in advance for your generosity. All are encouraged to come to Sunday school at 9 a.m. Mount Sinai class starts at 8:30 a.m. and studying the prophet Habakkuk. Habakkuk. We've had some problems with the pronunciations. Dinner and a Bible study is studying the fruits of the spirits. All are invited to attend at 6:30 p.m. on Sunday nights. Tonight's going to be the last night for the year. Then we'll start again at the beginning of the year. Because this thing called Christmas and the New Year's comes after this week. So, Monday morning Bible study has begun to study Nineveh and Jonah. All are invited to attend. Bible studies are a big part of our faith journey. So please find one and come to it. It's really, if we need another one and you think there's something you really want to study, we'll start a class. Save the date for New Year's Eve, December 31st, 2022. This sounds like fun. From 8 p.m. until midnight, a night for family, food, music, and fun. Music by the Victory Trio, Chosen, the Masters Trio, and the Home Lighters Quartet. And that is, once again, New Year's Eve at 8 p.m. here at the church. No reason not to come. Enjoy the night. The offering envelopes for 2023 are available in the narthex at this point. And please check the inserts in your bulletin for any additional announcements. Thank you for listening. And now it's time for the lighting of the Advent candle. For a big announcement for us.
Good morning. Last week I talked about the ongoing needs of the church and the gifts we are blessed to receive. The trustees met a few weeks ago to put together our Christmas list to send to Santa this year. So first, we asked Santa for a winning lottery ticket. We feel like we've been pretty good this year, so we're really hoping the jolly old man brings us that one. Because then we asked him for a new parking lot. You may have noticed our parking lot is deteriorating. We have a few full-fledged potholes along with some pretty good cracks. So before one of those cracks turns into a yawning chasm and someone falls into the abyss, never to be seen again, or one of the potholes swallows an SUV, we would like to get it fixed. We got estimates to tear it out and replace it, thereby making it good for the next 20 years or more at a cost of almost $100,000. or to repair it, seal it, and stripe it for 18. So if Santa does bring us the first thing on our list, we would go for the big fix. But in reality, we're looking at the more feasible $18,000 repair. But I am pleased to know that through the money we've raised in the designated fund for the parking lot, along with the pledges from Memorial Committee and Friday Cafe, we look forward to that work being done in the spring. And that's something to be excited about, I think. We also asked Santa to help us with our roof shingles. They're looking thin. Most of them are more than 20 years old, which is the average lifespan of a shingle. In the coming years, we're looking at needing to replace $100,000 worth of shingles. And that's at today's prices. We're hoping to be able to do this in phases, but still conceivably, we're looking at 4 to 5 phases at a cost of $20,000 to $25,000 for each phase. So if we do this over the next 4 to 5 years, you can do the math. It's $100,000 either way. Probably more with the way things are going up. So that's a concern. If our roof fails, we know what happens. We asked Santa to bring us repairs to the interior as a result of the roof leak last year. Now that the flat roof above the choir room has been repaired once winter has passed and we've been assured there are no further issues, we still need to have the choir room and the overflow area damage repaired. We asked Santa for electronic signs to replace our existing ones. If those signs don't appear under our Christmas tree, we are looking into the most inexpensive way to make this conversion. We found fully programmable, multicolored electronic signs that could be made to fit over our existing signs. We have the electric there already, and it's just a matter of making it work. The signs, materials, and labor for each sign cost about $2,000 each. We need 4 of them, so we're talking about $8,000. But compared to the original estimate to add one large monument-style sign like the one at Free Will Baptist, to the tune of about $40,000 or $50,000, we think this could be a good solution that would give us 4 smaller signs rather than one big one at a fraction of the cost. The outreach board is looking into this, and we're thinking about getting one for now to see how well it will be able to be installed on the existing signs. If it works, we order 3 more. If it doesn't, then we'll put it somewhere in the middle or mount it to the church wall. We'll make it work one way or another. I've looked at the specs, and I'm fully confident I can make it work the way we want it to. We feel this is an investment in getting the word out that we got a lot going on here on this little corner. The last thing we asked Santa for this year is a couple corral gates across to, we're trying to figure out a way to eliminate those flags. In the last month, I've had to go out there and repair them twice. I've seen broken glass out there where somebody's hit that thing. So we're trying to come up with a solution for that, and we're thinking maybe a couple driveway gates would be in order. These improvements are all the things we'd like to focus on in the coming year. We definitely have a lot going on in our little corner church house. Our building and grounds are starting to show signs of their age, and there are things we'd like to do to bring us into these modern times. This is God's house, and it's up to us to take care of it so that we have a safe and comfortable place in which to worship. We encourage you to continue to support these efforts through your second mile giving by helping to restore our building reserve fund, which is what we draw from to complete these tasks. If you haven't yet, be sure to turn in your pledges for the 2023 fiscal year. And on behalf of the trustees, we want to thank you for helping us accomplish these goals. Maybe Santa will bring us all the things we asked for this year, but since some of us have found ourselves on the naughty list, we may need a little help. We wish you a wonderful Christmas and a prosperous new year, and we look forward to another excellent year with all the exciting things to come here at Asbury South and our quest to spread the word of God right here and everywhere. Thank you.
So now, any more announcements? Okay. So now we have the lighting of the Advent candle, week 4, Love, Cindy Byers and Julie Hardbark.
Last Sunday, we lit the candle of hope, remembering the hope which comes in Christ. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of peace, remembering God's dream, a peaceful world. And we lit the candle of joy, remembering the spirit within us who brings joy. Today, we light the 4th candle of Advent, the candle of love. Scripture tells us, There is no fear in love, for perfect love casts out fear. God created this world in love, and this world will end in the love of God. In the love of God. God's love pervades all aspects of this life, from birth to death, pain to delight, strangers to lovers. God's love is there. We light this candle in love. On this day, remember, God is love.
Please rise as you are able to for the call to worship. Into the center of all darkness, God shines a bright new light. Thanks be to our God of hope. Amid the flurry of activity and busyness, God brings new life. Thanks be to our God of peace and joy. Despite our distractions, celebrations, and stress, God forgives and comforts us. Thanks to the God of our salvation. Praise to our God of love. If you can continue standing as we have praise music, and they're going to be singing What a Glorious Night.
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, which is Christ the Lord, the Savior. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was the angel and a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Christ is born. wandered, they couldn't hide it. Come on, everyone inside. All were amazed when they heard how God came down on this glorious night. God came down on this glorious night. I hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive her King. I know that love has come. Sing it out, Jesus Christ is born. Jesus Christ is born. Glorious, glorious, what a glorious night. Glorious, glorious, what a glorious night. I hear the angels singing,
clap,
hallelujah, let the earth receive her King. I know that love has come. Sing it out, Jesus Christ is born. Jesus Christ is born.
Sorry, a little mic problem. There we go. Let us prepare to go to God in prayer. Jesus Emmanuel, when your arrival happens, coming with you is new life, new power, new perspective, new love. We pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us now that we might experience Jesus Christ in new and different ways today, throughout the remainder of Advent, throughout Christmas. God, we pray that you would use our worship, our study, and our praise to open our minds that we might see you, to open our hearts that we may embrace you, and to open our lives that we might share who Jesus is in new and different and passionate ways. God, in the excitement of the season, when you need to, please slow us down so that we can focus on the things that matter. God, in our worship, please slow us down and focus us that we might focus on the things that are important today. May we see your people, your wonders, your Holy Son. Open the entirety of our souls to the presence of your Holy Spirit, now in our worship and forever in our lives. Amen. Now it's time for children's moments.
Hello, everyone. Young people? All right. Well, children of God, let me speak to you today. It's the Christmas season. Oh, we love the Christmas season. The Christmas spirit is upon us. And we use some words and we talk about things during this that represent the Christmas spirit, right? We hear words like peace, joy. These are words we use that kind of fall within the Christmas spirit. Kindness, generosity, gentleness, patience. You got to have patience, you know, dealing with the long lines and all the stresses that come with it, right? And this is all a part of the Christmas spirit. And we're celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ, who also brings the Holy Spirit to us. And through that, now this is where it gets crazy. What Jesus wants us to do is he wants us to have this spirit all year long. Because, you know, January 2nd comes around. What do? We put our heads down. We go, right, it's back to work, isn't it? Christmas is over. The Christmas spirit's done, right? No. We have this thing called the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, gentleness. Sound alike, don't they? Words we use during the Christmas with the Christmas spirit are the fruits of the Spirit that we're supposed to then have all year long. So while we sing our favorite songs now, January 2nd, continue to sing your favorite songs. They don't have to be Christmas songs. Go ahead, sing your favorite hymn. During now, when we're walking around town, saying Merry Christmas to everybody. Come January 2nd, say, hey, Happy Tuesday to everybody. Hey, Merry Wednesday. How's your third week of February going? Get that spirit with you. Gifts can go all year long. They don't have to be physical wrap gifts. Your gift of time is probably one of the most wonderful gifts you can give anybody. Your gifts that are given to you by God to help other people in whatever you can do. Greg plays beautiful music, and he gives that gift all the time. Thank you. That's a gift you can give. Tim has the gift of being able to do stuff. Thank you, Tim, for that gift. Whatever gift you have, you can give that all year long. In the spirit of Christmas, the spirit of the Lord, the fruits of the Spirit. Carry that with you as we go through Christmas. Enjoy this Christmas. And then come January 2nd, keep that spirit with you and move forward and keep doing it all year long. Because that, as we get ready for the hope and the wonder of the birth of Jesus Christ, is what Christ wants us to do all year long. The best gift I can give you today is the gift of a prayer that was given to me through the Bible. And I'd like to give it to you as a gift to keep with you because I love this prayer. This prayer has done a lot for me. It's a prayer by Thomas Merton. Now, you've heard it before because I've said it before and I'll say it again and I enjoy it. So let's come together in prayer. My Lord God, I have no idea where I'm going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think that I'm following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen. So now go out and enjoy Christmas and the Christmas spirit and live in the fruits of the Spirit all year long. All right. So now the chancel choir will sing a song for us.
Back here, you have to sing.
Thank you.
The scripture reading today is from Matthew 1, 18 through 25. This is adapted from the New Century Version of the Bible. The birth of Jesus Christ. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother, Mary, was engaged to marry Joseph. But before they married, she learned she was pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because Mary's husband, Joseph, was a good man, he didn't want to disgrace her in public. So he planned to divorce her secretly. While Joseph thought about these things, an angel of the Lord came to him in a dream. The angel said, "Joseph, descendant of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because the baby in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this has happened to bring about what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be pregnant. She will have a son, and they will name him Emmanuel, which means God. When Joseph woke up, he did what the Lord's angel had told him. Joseph took Mary as his wife, but he did not have sexual relations with her until she gave birth to the son, and Joseph named him Jesus. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God.
Amen. Let us pray. Oh God, as your Spirit spoke clearly to Mary and then to Joseph, we ask that you speak clearly to us now, that through the proclamation of your word, we might hear, understand, and then go out and share what we have learned and experienced in worship today. May it be your word and your word only that is shared and received today. Amen. What's in a name? Let's see how you guys do with some trivia. We'll start with somebody from the Dayton area, because that's where I'm from. Does anybody know who the actor from Dayton is? His name is Ramon Estevez. Martin Sheen, very good. What about Norma Jean Mortensen? Who is Michael King Jr.? Yeah, I thought I might trick you with that one. He gets a holiday in January. African-American civil rights leader, Martin Luther King Jr. Now, here's another one. Does anybody know who Carla Kay is? Both names start with a K. Okay, I have to confess, that's a trick question, because none of you will know who Carla Kay is, and actually her full name really would have been Carla Kay Upchurch, except that my father, Carl with a K, said absolutely not, and I became Sherri instead of Carla Kay. Now, truthfully, I would have been honored to be named after my father, except, number one, you know, all of us have those letters that we can't write that look really awful. Okay, so K is one of those for me, so I'm kind of excited that I don't have two Ks in my name. But more than that, I can't imagine myself as Carla Kay. And as close as I came to being that person, names matter. You know, this is a true story. I once met someone whose name, not their nickname, but his name was Bubba. And at first I thought I was just being tricked that I'm gullible, because I am. But Bubba was a fully grown male who stood about 5'4", so a little bit taller than me, and weighed about 135 pounds. And that was probably soaking wet with two big jackets on. I'm not sure about you, but to me it seems like Bubba should be like 6 feet tall and 250 pounds. Or a child. A grown Bubba at 5'4 and 135 just didn't seem to work for me. Then there's this other person I met. And she is, by all accounts, the human version of Eeyore. Everybody knows who Eeyore is, right? You know what her name is? Joy. It's too bad Joy's parents couldn't see the future. Maybe they would have rethought that name for her, because apparently naming her Joy didn't lead to any joy in her life. I will say to them, good try, though. They tried. So why am I going on and on about this? Because I want to talk about what's in a name. I didn't want to leave it to chance, so that's why I said specifically, names matter. They do matter. So much so that sometimes people actually change their names for different reasons. Maybe to help with their professions, like Ramon Estevez or Norma Jean Mortensen. Or sometimes people change their names because another person, living or dead, has had such a profound impact on them that they want to honor that person with their name, like Martin Luther on Michael King Sr. What's in a name? Everything. Names matter. We know that, but it's not just a common thing today. Historically, names have mattered. Historically, knowing the name of someone or something like a god was believed to give the knower the power of the person or entity whose name they possessed or they knew. This belief appears over and over in a variety of ancient cultures, as well as in the Jewish, Egyptian, Hindu, and to some extent in the Christian culture. For example, the ancient Egyptians believed that a person assumed the power of a god if the person knew that god's name. It's very similar to what the Israelites believed, which makes it so important that God gave God's name. That's a big deal. What's in a name? Now, what does that have to do with our passage? Well, think about this. We read in the scripture these words, right? They were told to name him Jesus, so they did, the end. Is that right? Yeah. Well, what about the prophecy that's thrown in there? After all, it doesn't say that his first name is Jesus, his middle name is Emmanuel, and his last name is Christ. It doesn't say that, does it? So we see you're supposed to name him Jesus. And then it says he's the fulfillment of prophecy, and you're supposed to name him Emmanuel. And then it comes back with, you're supposed to name him Jesus. Now, when I read that as a kid, I scratched my head. Did I miss something here? Name him Jesus. Name him Emmanuel. We named him Jesus. No mention that both names are used. What is going on here? It says in verse 23, the prophecy, the virgin will be pregnant and they will name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. But it starts and ends with, you will name him Jesus. Because what does verse 25 say? And Joseph named him Jesus. So is it Emmanuel or is it Jesus? I'll give you a hint. What do you think his name was? His name, so the answer is actually not both. His name is Jesus. That's his name. And names matter. Think about what else is said in there. It says, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. You will name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. That's what the angel says to Mary and to Joseph. The name Emmanuel, which is actually not a name, it's actually a title, really, it's what's in the scripture. They're quoting Isaiah when that comes in. The scripture says the virgin, it doesn't say Mary, the virgin will be pregnant, she will have a son, and they will name him Emmanuel. The prophecy says you will name him Jesus. Do you hear a difference one word makes? They will name him Emmanuel. Another way of saying it is they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. They will name him Emmanuel. You will name him Jesus. But again, a better translation would be, they will call him Emmanuel, but you will name him Jesus. Have any of you ever been called by something that's not your name? I'm talking about positive. Let's keep it positive here. Think about people like Elizabeths, who are often called Betty or Beth or Betsy, or Biddy. We have all kinds of things that we call people. It's all in a name. I'm going to cite a website, and it's got a long name, and it's thattheworldmayknow.com/mygodisyahveh. And this is the quote, because I think it's really good. It says, names are important in Western culture. Parents choose names for their children after much thought and discussion. For the rest of a person's life, he or she is identified by the name they were given before birth. But the significance of names in our day cannot compare to the significance of names in biblical times. Ancient peoples understood that a name expressed the entity or the essence or identity of a person. According to Proverbs 22, verse 1, a good name is more desirable than riches. In the biblical world, a good name meant more than a good reputation because a good name identified the character of the person carrying it. The article goes on for a while, but it says this. Think of it this way. In the ancient Near East, a person's name sometimes identified something about their character or their circumstances, for example, their birth family. Isaac's name, he laughs, described the response of, actually I think it's supposed to be she laughs, describes the response of Sarah, his mother, when God told her that she was going to give birth in old age. Moses' name, from the Hebrew to draw out, was given to him after he was pulled out of the Nile River. According to our text, that's the end of the quote, by the way. According to our text, the angel told Mary to name her baby Jesus, which is actually a Greek rendering for the Hebrew name Yeshua, which is short for Yahashua and is sometimes translated Joshua. So think Elizabeth, Beth, or Betty, Yehoshua, which is sometimes Jesus, or Joshua. Those are Hebrew names that all mean Savior or to save. And why did the angel tell them to name him Jesus, which was a name, not a title, that was his name? If it means to save or Savior, see where the angel was going? I'm just saying, it's a foreshadowing, because I don't know about you, but I know Jesus as the Savior. Jesus is his name, identifying something about his circumstance or his character. He's going to be the Savior. The others are titles, identifying or clarifying his role. So his name is Jesus, but his titles are Christ, Messiah, Savior, Lord, Emmanuel, and that just is to name a few. There's all kinds of titles for him. Emmanuel, like Christ, is a title. Christ means Messiah. So Jesus is his first name. Christ is not his last name, it's a title. God wants people to understand two things. Jesus is God with us, Emmanuel, and Jesus is our Savior. I'm pretty sure that's a good assessment. Think about this. We don't know his last name. What we do know, what would have been important at the time, is that he is the descendant of the house of David through his father, Joseph. And that's what we need to know. What do our surnames tell us? The same thing. What's our lineage? I can tell you this, my lineage is from the house of Upchurch. Jesus came from the house of David. We don't know anything else, but don't we know enough? He's the Savior, and he is God with us. Do we need more than that? I'm going to go out on a limb and say, that's enough for me. Yes, we call him Messiah, because he was the Messiah, the Savior, the chosen one. God with us, the Son of God, all of those titles are true. So in our scripture, it is actually not inconsistent. His name is Jesus, and they will call him Emmanuel, God with us. What did Jesus do? Jesus is the Savior. He is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is the promised one. He is also God with us. He came as one of us to be among us. And then when he left, who did he leave in his place? The Holy Spirit, who is God? So is God still with us? You know the answer. Is God still with us? Yes. Amen. God continues to be with us right up to today, right into the future where Jesus comes back to be present once again. Jesus means the Lord saves. And Jesus came to earth to save us, not because we can save ourselves. We can't save ourselves. No matter how good we try to be, we can't remove the sinful nature that is part of us as human beings. Only Jesus can do that. And only Jesus came to do that. And we can respond by living a life that testifies to who Jesus is and what Jesus did. He's the Savior. He saved us. So we can do all that, or we can continue to be busy with the world's things. But we want to remember this. The name is Jesus, which means save or savior. And the baby Jesus comes to save, and the baby Jesus saves. He is the fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy. He is Emmanuel. He is the Christ. He is God in human form. So God was with us when the world was created. God was with us physically in Jesus. God is with us in the Holy Spirit. Emmanuel, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God is Emmanuel, and the one who came to save us is Jesus. Jesus came specifically to be the Christ, the Savior, the Messiah. What's in a name? Identity, circumstance, lineage. What's in a name? Power and authority. And if the name is Jesus, what's in a name? Life. Life is in Jesus. Now think of this. Many expectant parents devote a great deal of time pondering all the name options for their child. But Mary and Joseph didn't have to think about what to name their child. First of all, they didn't have time. Second of all, God handed them the baby's name, as well as a long list of titles. But God handed them the most powerful name in the history of creation. What's in a name? Hope, peace, joy, love, life. When the name is Jesus, what's in a name? When the name is Jesus, absolutely everything that ever will matter is in that name. What's in his name? Salvation. What's in a name? If it's Jesus, it's life. Let us prepare to pray, and let us remember as we move towards Christmas, which is a season, not a day. In the church, it's the season that starts on Christmas and ends in Epiphany. So actually, for us, the Christmas season doesn't end on January 2nd. It ends with Epiphany. We are to be celebrating the one whose name is Jesus. And we are going to go in prayer. I have a long list. I'll try to go through it because we did not do our prayer list last week. So here's the list of names. We're going to have our prayers and our praises, and then we will pray. So today we pray for Maggie and Dave Stewart. They are friends of Margaret Johnson, who are recovering from COVID. We pray for Diane and Bill Lott's grandson, Braden, who is recovering from COVID. We pray for Angie Rogers' sister, Alice, who lost her husband and is facing health concerns of her own. We pray for the Bickert family because Oscar Sr. has been placed in hospice care. We pray for Jeffrey Prince, who joined the Air Force and departed for basic training on December 5th. We prayed past tense for Diana Sexton's outpatient procedure to go well last week, and now we pray for good test results. We pray for Bob Sherman and his family. Bob's father passed away on the 9th, and they celebrated his life this week. We pray for Ron and Kathy Castile's friends, Chuck and Cindy Moeller, who have COVID, and Cindy is Kathy's longtime best friend. We pray for Wilma Hill's friend, Michael Hugo, who has multiple health issues. We continue to pray for Deb Schnittke, and we have unspoken requests from three different church families. But we also praise God today that Margaret Johnson's friend, Dave Dudley, is now in rehab in Dallas. And if you remember, Dave is the one that we started praying for because he wasn't expected to survive. So thanks be to God for that. We praise God that Dick Sloan's sister, Carol Sloan, who has been in a coma for months, was up and sitting in a chair on Monday, December 5th. So God is active. Yes. Dave got to come home Wednesday, so thanks be to God. Dave Dudley is actually home. So if you get it, sometimes we get in those places where we forget the power of God. God is still answering prayers in mighty ways. So let us now, during this season of eager anticipation of what God's doing, let us go to God in prayer. God, at simply the utterance of the name Jesus, you offer us new life. Yet though you come as a human being in Jesus, still we sometimes do not fully understand how to live a truly authentic Christian life because our humanity gets in the way. We love Jesus. We are grateful for the man. We are grateful for the name because our lives depend upon him. We are empowered when we call upon his name, and yet sometimes it seems as though we don't know him at all, and sometimes when it matters most, we fail to call upon him. Sometimes it's our lack of study, our lack of focus, our lack of preparedness, our lack of direction. All of those things can get in the way of our relationship with you, God, our service to you, God, and our dedication to being his body. We confess that particularly during Advent, going into Christmas, we are distracted with lists of things we want to accomplish before December 25th. We are busy. And sometimes, God, because we get tired with all of our busyness, we become spiritually lazy. And we neglect our spiritual disciplines in order to squeeze more worldly activity into our days. For this, we say we are sorry, God. Forgive us for all of our sins and all of our shortcomings, and renew in us the childlike wonder that was there the first time we heard about Jesus and the manger that first was empty and then held a baby. Help us see the world through the eyes of Christ's compassion. As we kneel at your altar today, we relinquish to your custody all the cares and concerns of our lives, our families, our neighbors, our world, and in particular, those prayers that we lifted up. We thank you for all of the answers, those that have already arrived and those for which we wait. And we pray that you would comfort us when we receive answers and responses that look different from what we truly want. Whenever possible, please reveal why your answer isn't what we want, but still is in our best interest. And when you can't reveal it, just love us for struggling, because sometimes it's the best we can do. God, be with all of those who grieve during this season that the rest of us are joyfully celebrating. And inspire all of us who know you to be more and more like Jesus in every way we can. For it is truly in his name and by his power that we pray and do all things. Amen. Now let us join our voices and pray the prayer that the grown-up Jesus comes and teaches us, saying this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
It's now time for the invitation of offering. Let us come with boldness and with gratitude into the presence of the Lord. Bring with us the fruits of our labors and the gifts of our service and love. Let us prepare our minds and hearts to present our gifts and offerings to God of our salvation. I invite the ushers to come forward. God of all mercy and compassion, you have brought us all salvation in the form of the infant Jesus, and we are eternally grateful. You have restored us in every way possible, and you have filled our lives with blessings. The best gift ever is Jesus and eternal life. We cannot outgive you, but we can ask for your blessing. Our prayer is that you would be delighted by our sincere and generous giving. Please surround us with love, overflowing, and wrap this offering in your blessing and goodwill, that it would be used to shine your love and your light into this community. Amen. If you could please remain standing as we sing Emmanuel, Emmanuel, number 204 in your hymnal. Thank you.
actually am going to go ahead and do my blessing. And I'm prayerfully sharing this with you. I had a nice little poem prepared, but the Holy Spirit is telling me to share something, I guess, more important. I'm going to make it short, but it's a true story, and it's about the name of Jesus. It's about the power in names. Be careful of uttering names. Many decades ago, when I was a much younger Christian, and I was much less knowledgeable, without thinking, I uttered a name, and I challenged that name. And that entity showed up, because without thinking, I uttered an incantation, and that name brought something that I didn't want around, and I freaked out. There's power in a name. What happens when the name is Jesus? Absolutely everything. Because when I came back to my wits, what do you think I did? I called upon the name of Jesus and asked Jesus and Jesus' Holy Spirit to take control of the space and control of me. And that's what Jesus did. It's not just words that we say. There's power in the name of Jesus. And when you find yourself in a bad spot, whether it's today or whether it's in Christmas season or whenever, call upon the power of Jesus and he will show up. Jesus has all power over all beings and all people. What's in a name? When the name is Jesus, there is absolutely everything in that name. And so by the power and authority of Jesus the Christ, Jesus, our Emmanuel, go forth in anticipation. Go forth ready for celebration. Go forth and represent Jesus. Go forth and serve the Lord. Amen.